Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you very much for being here for this gallery talk today. My name is Stephen Fagin, and it's a real pleasure to talk about a subject we really don't address very often at this museum, and that is the very dramatic World War II adventure of PT-109. You know, as a kid, I read a lot of Kennedy biographies. And this was always the quintessential image of young Jack Kennedy, World War II hero. Pretty much without exception, this photo appears in every book, accompanied by text about the sinking of PT-109 and how that experience shaped Kennedy as a man and laid down a clear path towards his future. Here's one such biographical account. World War II changed Jack in many ways. He never forgot his war experience and the bravery of his crew. His brother Joe also died during the war. Jack wanted to make a difference. He decided to be a politician. This is the making of a hero's narrative, and it would carry John F. Kennedy through the rest of his life and help cultivate a remarkable legacy after his death. But you know, you never really see this alternative image, very rarely, and especially you don't see this one, even though all three of these pictures were taken within just moments of each other. Even though the one on the right is an action pose with his hand on the wheel, Kennedy looks skinny, too young, got kind of a scrawny neck. The one on the left, he's too moody and contemplative. It has to be the one in the middle, smiling, charismatic, just a hint of rebelliousness and full of that youthful vigor, a president in the making. So as with the entire story of PT-109, it's always a matter of carefully selecting the image that best fits the story. And this is a story that would forge an identity both political and personal. So here's the story in brief. After being medically disqualified from entering Army Officer Cadet School in 1940, Kennedy pulled some strings and, with help from a family friend, joined the U.S. Naval Reserve in 1941. He volunteered for motor torpedo boat training, and in April 1943, as a lieutenant junior grade, he took command of PT-109 in the Solomon Islands. Now, PT-109 was an 80-foot by 20-foot boat made largely out of plywood. It ran on gasoline, held up to 4 torpedoes, and had a maximum speed of 40 to 45 knots. PT boats were dangerous little crafts. They were designed for low-speed ambushes at night with decent maneuverability on the water. In the South Pacific, they were used to monitor and disrupt what was called the Tokyo Express, that is, the shipping lane used by Japanese destroyers to deliver personnel, supplies, and equipment to their forces in the Solomons. August 1st, 1943. PT-109 is one of 15 PT boats sent through Ferguson Passage to Blackett Strait to watch for enemy destroyers making a nighttime supply run. Operating under radio silence in total darkness, there was no way to coordinate an attack. 30 torpedoes were fired by 4 divisions of PT boats, scoring not one single hit. Most of the boats fired their torpedoes and left, but PT-109 and 2 other boats lingered to patrol the area. The 109 was idling on one engine, operating without radar. And then famously, around 2 a.m. on August 2nd, Kennedy and his crew suddenly found themselves in the path of this Japanese destroyer, the Amagiri. PT-109 was split right in two, or by some accounts, had a large chunk of its right rear section just sheared off. The tanks ruptured and ignited. 2 crew members were killed instantly. 11 survivors, including Kennedy, lingered with the wreckage, hoping for rescue until the following afternoon, when they swam 3.5 miles to nearby Plum Pudding Island. And Kennedy, who had been on the Harvard swim team, did tow an injured crew member by clutching the strap of his life jacket in his teeth. The crew was rescued a week later, actually 6 days, although a couple of accounts stretch it all the way out to 9. No question, they all survived because of Kennedy's quick thinking and sheer perseverance. But with regard to the sinking itself, Kennedy initially feared that he was going to be court-martialed. And based on the various naval regulations that had been broken or overlooked, there was certainly reason for him to think that. Prior to the mission, PT-109 had dumped its only life raft in favor of a gun that was simply lashed, not bolted, to the deck, and it ultimately never fired a shot. Also, Kennedy had allegedly allowed two crew members to sleep during their patrol that night. Two others, while awake, were laying down at the time of the incident. But the story of PT-109 was already morphing into World War II legend as Kennedy's father, former Ambassador Joseph P. Kennedy, spun a vivid tale for local news media. There was a two-week naval inquiry, but those transcripts do not exist. The official report on the sinking was written by an intelligence officer named Byron White, who Kennedy later appointed to the United States Supreme Court. Perhaps the most visually interesting example of this recasting of the PT-109 story is this photograph. Joe Kennedy had pushed for his son to receive the Silver Star for bravery in action, but ultimately he was awarded a Purple Heart along with the Navy and Marine Corps Medal, which recognized his life-saving heroics after the sinking. Settling for this, Joe Kennedy at the very least wanted the commander of the South Pacific, Fleet Admiral Chester Nimitz, to present the award. But instead, an unnamed Navy captain gave Kennedy the medal. But during Kennedy's first congressional campaign in 1946, this photo was widely distributed with a caption stating that the fellow here is Fleet Admiral Chester Nimitz, which I suppose was probably just a typographical error. But with the idea of PT-109 and political campaigns in mind, let's go ahead and take a moment and watch this very interesting 1960 campaign spot for Kennedy that was hosted by actor Henry Fonda.
Ladies and gentlemen, Henry Fonda.
I've always been an admirer of Franklin D. Roosevelt. So I was especially interested recently when I saw a movie of FDR as a young man. His fight against polio, his courage, his endurance, his will to live. It was an experience that history says had a deep influence on the leadership he gave our country as president. At a time when our country was hurt and stricken, when we all needed courage and endurance. I know another man like that with the same strong character, the indomitable will to live. This I've known for over 15 years. Ever since I read an article in the Reader's Digest by John Hersey about a young naval officer in the Solomon Islands during some of the darkest days and nights of World War II. August 2nd, 1943 in the South Pacific. A U.S. Navy PT boat is patrolling the Solomons. The Japanese fleet is everywhere. 3 miles to the northeast, 10,000 Japanese are on Kolombangara Island. 5 miles to the west is Vella Lavella, more Japanese. 1 mile south, the Japanese camp on Gizo. The PT boat is cruising quietly. At the wheel is her captain, Navy Lieutenant John F. Kennedy. Suddenly, out of the dark night, a Japanese destroyer bears down at 40 knots and rams the PT boat in two. Thrown on his back on the deck, Lieutenant Kennedy stares up to see the destroyer pass through his boat. But half the PT boat stays afloat, and Lieutenant Kennedy helps 10 other survivors hang on. Eventually, they leave the sinking hulk and swim for a small island 3 miles southwest. One man has been badly injured. Lieutenant Kennedy ties a strap to the man's life jacket and tows him with his teeth the entire distance. It takes 5 hours to swim it. Lost for 9 days in enemy territory, Lieutenant Kennedy painfully, slowly swims from island to island, reef to reef, scouting for help, watching the seas and straits for other PT boats. He drifts, floats, sleeps while being carried by the current. For days, he swims back to lead them to another island, swimming, drifting, treading over sharp coral, once more towing the injured man with his teeth. On the ninth day, it ends. An SOS Lieutenant Kennedy had carved on a coconut shell and given to a native, got past the Japanese and reached the Allies. And finally, one of the PT boats Lieutenant Kennedy had been searching for picks them up. "Hey, Jack," someone calls from the boat. "Where have you been?" asks Kennedy. "We've got some food for you." "No, thanks," says Kennedy. "I just had a coconut."
Senator Kennedy never liked talking about this himself, but I was a member of that crew. And believe me, we really had it rough. I would like you to know what the Navy said when he was decorated. His outstanding courage, endurance, and leadership contributed to the saving of several lives and were in keeping with the highest tradition of United States Naval Service.
Courage, endurance, leadership. John F. Kennedy has them all the way, and the way has been the hard way. As president, John F. Kennedy will have the courage to meet the greatest challenge our country has ever faced. He'll have the endurance to do the work, to maintain the patience, to possess the raw nerve we need in a world where our enemies would like to win by wearing us down. And he will give us leadership for the 60s, a new American leadership for the world beyond the seas to honor and respect. FDR, a man who loved the sea. John F. Kennedy, another man of the sea. His hand will be a strong hand on the ship of state.
Of all the celebrities who backed John F. Kennedy, Henry Fonda was the perfect vehicle to deliver the PT-109 story. Fonda was an American everyman, having been nominated for an Oscar for his portrayal of Tom Joad in The Grapes of Wrath, and having given up Hollywood for a time to serve in the Navy during World War II, and like Kennedy, he was a lieutenant junior grade. The comparisons that he makes here to the ardently admired Franklin Roosevelt are very important. Kennedy sought to carry on with that great democratic tradition, and he went to great lengths to get the support of party elders like Eleanor Roosevelt and former President Harry Truman. Coming from Fonda, who had embodied the potential of the New Deal in The Grapes of Wrath, and as an actor who had once portrayed young Abraham Lincoln, this comparison is conveyed here with a great sense of authority. Now, Fonda mentions the famous coconut shell. Going back to the rescue for a moment, Kennedy and his men survived for 5 days before they were found by two scouts dispatched by an Australian coast watcher. The scout's canoe was too small to rescue the survivors, so Kennedy inscribed a message on a coconut shell for the scouts to take back to the Allied forces. The message read in part, "Native knows position, he can pilot, 11 alive, need small boat, Kennedy." A memorial service had already been held for the crew, although this is seldom mentioned. Prior to the coconut's arrival, there had not been any search and rescue efforts at all. The PT boats that were nearby that night had assumed from the explosion that everyone was killed, and they never went back to check for survivors. The shell was preserved in a glass paperweight, which sat on Kennedy's desk in the Oval Office, and it's always there in the background throughout the Kennedy administration, reminding Kennedy of that harrowing experience, and also, and perhaps more importantly, reminding others of his heroism. Here's the paperweight close-up view as it's now displayed at the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library and Museum in Boston. It was hard not to know the story of PT-109 during that 1960 presidential campaign because it was everywhere. Although Kennedy himself rarely spoke of it, his friends, his family, and the survivors themselves were all dispatched to echo the story far and wide, a narrative like the Henry Fonda ad that was largely based on a 1944 story called Survival, written by Pulitzer Prize-winning author John Hersey in cooperation with Kennedy. Now, Hersey added novelistic flourishes to flesh out and humanize Kennedy's story, poetically exploring the psychology of survival. Here's a two-sentence example. "His mind seemed to float away from his body. Darkness and time took the place of a mind in his skull." Ensign Barney Ross, who survived the sinking, said years later, "We were kind of ashamed of our performance. I always thought it was a disaster, but Hersey made it sound pretty heroic, like Dunkirk." Hersey's story was intended for Life magazine, but was actually published in The New Yorker when Life rejected it. Joe Kennedy wanted it available to the masses, so a condensed version that focused almost entirely on Kennedy rather than the rest of his crew ran in Reader's Digest. 100,000 reprints of the Reader's Digest article were ordered during Jack's congressional campaign, and even more were distributed during the 1960 presidential election. And PT-109 was a key symbol of the Kennedy campaign, as you can see from several of the artifacts we have on display in our special exhibit. This tie clip was arguably the most popular campaign trinket of 1960, as it was personally distributed by Kennedy as he traveled across the United States. It proved so popular, in fact, that after the election, a new version without the 60 was produced, and Kennedy continued to keep several of these on hand to give out when he traveled or met visitors at the White House. One imagines that a Kennedy 64 version would likely have been produced had he run to had he lived to run for re-election. PT-109 was not missing from Kennedy's inaugural festivities on January 20th, 1961. This huge float was part of the inaugural parade with survivors of the real ship on board. These veterans had been crucial campaigners for Kennedy, as we saw in the Fonda ad. They were always emphasizing his bravery and his leadership skills. And as president, Kennedy received a number of awards and mementos specifically referencing PT-109. For example, here, the Boys Club of America gives the president a miniature PT-109 in a bottle. And in 1963, the Washington International Boat and Sports Show presented the president with a big model of PT-109, which ended up, appropriately enough, in the fish room at the White House. In pop culture, the story was cast in song in 1962 by country artist and television personality Jimmy Dean, who would start his own sausage company here in Texas a few years later. PT-109 reached number 8 on the pop charts and number 3 on the country western charts. And hot on the heels of the Jimmy Dean record was the Warner Brothers feature film PT-109, actually the first commercial film made about a sitting U.S. president. The $4 million movie, based on a very flattering 1961 book by Robert Donovan, was produced in cooperation with the Kennedy White House. In fact, Kennedy personally selected actor Cliff Robertson to portray him, overruling Jackie's choice of Warren Beatty. Cliff Robertson was only about 5 years younger than President Kennedy, making him about 15 years too old to play the part of the young World War II lieutenant. Yet the end result was a mature actor who exuded authority, leadership, and charisma. So perhaps the age difference was intentional. It's worth noting that Warren Beatty at the time was the exact age that Kennedy was in 1943. The film's summer 1963 release, reminding voters who would be running for re-election the next year, was not successful, though it was heavily marketed towards young people with this tie-in comic book, for example. Here is that famous photo once again, and you can see Cliff Robertson below trying just a little too hard to replicate that pose for a publicity stunt. He just does not have that relaxed Kennedy demeanor. Now, the president enjoyed the film, but he thought that at 2.5 hours, it might be a little too long, much like this gallery talk. As part of the film's publicity, this dramatic display was unveiled at the famed Movieland Wax Museum in California. Now, what's interesting about this tableau is it's meant to show Cliff Robertson in character during the filming, hence the clapboard that you see on the ship there. Yet it depicts a figure that looks closer to young Kennedy rather than Robertson. And when this set was revised a few years later following the assassination, look at this. You can see that all pretense of this being actor Cliff Robertson has disappeared. Not only has the clapboard been removed, but this is the revised figure's head is very much that of President Kennedy, the recognizable 1960s figure, not the young Navy lieutenant. And notice the heroic pose, you know, looking up with his arm outstretched. This small but important revision, this is the PT-109 story of valor as legacy, seen through the prism of a post-assassination world. Nothing kept PT-109 alive in the pop culture more than model ships. These were readily available to hobbyists in the early 1960s, and model ships of PT-109 in some form or another have been in production for more than half a century, making it one of the best-selling model ships of all time. Notice here, as with all the model ships I've ever seen, that lifeboat on the deck is very clearly visible, which is not historically accurate because Kennedy and his crew had removed the lifeboat prior to going out that night, and they had replaced it with a gun that was lashed to the deck with rope. We even have a huge and really impressive model of PT-109 in our museum store and cafe across the street, if you'd like to take a look at that. The legacy of PT-109 lives on in stranger ways also. In May 1997, to mark what would have been the president's 80th birthday, Kennedy's second cousin, Kerry McCarthy, released a line of PT-109-themed nautical wear. The line was intended to celebrate Kennedy's love of the sea and honor his heroism through collectible jackets, t-shirts, sweatshirts, and hats. Most interesting, perhaps, is the PT wear patch on all the item, which looks at first glance to be a little like an insect on top of a torpedo. And that's because that's exactly what it is. This is the actual emblem of the Navy's PT boats based on the nickname the Mosquito Fleet, so named because they were characterized as fragile, small, vulnerable boats which carried lethal power. This emblem on the right here was actually drawn by artists at the Walt Disney Studio, one of hundreds of emblems and insignias designed by Disney during World War II. Saving perhaps the best for last and demonstrating that PT-109 continues to matter in the new millennium, we have Hasbro's special edition G.I. Joe action figure from the year 2000. It was created in partnership with the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library, which received a portion of the proceeds. Kennedy as action hero comes complete with sunglasses, knife, pistol, dog tags, and an unfortunately oversized coconut shell. Still, it is fascinating to imagine young G.I. Joe fans in the year 2000 acting out the PT-109 story. And on the back of the box, of course, we end where it all began, with that signature image, a photograph that inspired a number of people around the world, including a young Navy officer who went on to become an oceanographer, Robert Ballard, the scientist who discovered the Titanic in 1986. In 2002, Ballard, working with National Geographic, discovered PT-109 in its final resting place, where it was photographed but not disturbed. The last survivor of PT-109 had died just the year before, but the two scouts, natives of the Solomon Islands, who had helped rescue Kennedy and his crew, were still living at the time. National Geographic recorded their first and only on-camera interview as part of this search for PT-109 project. Now, these natives had never read the John Hersey story. They had never seen the Henry Fonda campaign ad, and they certainly didn't have any PT wear. But they remembered that young lieutenant as vivacious and determined, destined for great things. PT-109 may have been carefully woven into Kennedy's political identity, and many still have legitimate questions about the collision and the sinking, but no one really disputes that Kennedy's leadership, under tremendous strain and adversity, his stamina and his survival instincts carried through that during that endeavor. And that memory, that brief encounter with the reality of PT-109, was the only legacy those natives of the Solomon Islands ever needed. So much so that one of them named his son John F. Kennedy. All right, well, thank you very much for being here, folks. Enjoy the rest of your visit to the 6th Floor Museum. Have a good day.